Now let us move on to matrix or stroma. Inside this envelope, as you see here, this envelope has a fluid, that is the aqueous fluid, which is made up of protein colloidal complex. It is made up of protein colloidal complex. Means this matrix, which is also known as stroma, it is formed of protein colloidal complex. And what else this matrix or this stroma is containing, let us discuss that one by one. Okay, it contains first of all granules. It contains granules, and these granules can be of phytoferritin or they can be some other mineral elements. Okay, phytoferritin or some other mineral elements. Next, this matrix or this stroma also contains enzymes. It also contains enzymes. Now these enzymes are very important for the photosynthesis reaction to occur. What function do these enzymes actually perform in case of chloroplast? Let us just give you an overview of this. They actually help in the synthesis of photosynthetic pigments. Which is a photosynthetic pigment? It is chlorophyll. I told you earlier also that chlorophyll is contained in this thylakoid. This one thylakoid, okay? So in the thylakoids there are photosynthetic pigment, that is chlorophyll. So that chlorophyll is synthesized by what? By the action of certain enzymes. So enzymes are helping the chloroplast to synthesize what? Photosynthetic pigments. And it is not just one function they are performing. They perform several other functions also. The next function, very important function the enzyme perform, is this operating Calvin cycle. Now this Calvin cycle is actually, I can also call it as light independent reaction. This Calvin cycle involves what? It involves light independent reaction. Means photosynthesis is going to take place. Food is going to be manufactured in the plant independent of light. And this process, this reaction we call as light independent reaction. And sometimes it is also called as dark reaction. It is also called as dark reaction. Now, which enzyme, which is the key enzyme of this Calvin cycle or this light independent reaction or the dark reaction? This enzyme is Rubisco. It is Rubisco. So, where this enzyme is present? This enzyme is present in the stroma or the matrix of chloroplast. These granules, these enzymes, which are very important, they are present where? They are present in the matrix or stroma of the chloroplast. So, not only this, there are some other functions also. They also help in the lipid synthesis or degradation. Then they also help in the starch synthesis and degradation. So, lipid and starch synthesis and degradation. So, this is how the enzymes perform very important function in case of the chloroplast. Okay, the granules are present, the enzymes are present, and this enzymes form actually very important function, that is mostly in the case of synthesis of this photosynthetic pigments. And this Calvin cycle, which you will discuss later on, this light independent reaction, just here just remember that food is also manufactured independent of the light. Okay, for that manufacturing process, plants do not need light actually. Means it is not like they do not need light. They actually are light independent. Okay. It's better to call light independent. Why we call better it as light independent? We will discuss later when we are going to discuss this Calvin cycle and all these processes. So remember that this reaction is also known as dark reaction. And this dark reaction is actually facilitated by this very important key enzyme, that is Rubisco. So these enzymes are present in the matrix or the stroma of chloroplast. Next, they also help in the lipid and starch synthesis and degradation. Next, what does the stroma else actually contain for you? It contains, I told you, plastids have their own genetic material, and chloroplast is a form of plastid, green colored plastid. So it also contains DNA. DNA is what? Deoxyribonucleic acid. And this DNA, in case of chloroplast, we call it as chloroplast ctDNA. We call it as ctDNA, that is chloroplast DNA. Now generally this chloroplast DNA is circular, but occasionally sometimes it can also be linear. Linear occasionally, or you can say sometimes it can also be linear, but generally it is what? This chloroplast DNA, that is ctDNA, is generally what? It is circular, and there are around 2 to 6 copies of this. ctDNA has 2 to 6 copies, and this DNA is actually what? It is making this chloroplast semi-autonomous. It makes this chloroplast as semi-autonomous. So it is going to perform replication also and transcription also. Replication and transcription. So this ctDNA, this chloroplast DNA, is usually circular, but it can be linear also. Okay, occasionally there are 2 to 6 copies of this ctDNA, chloroplast DNA. It makes the chloroplast semi-autonomous because this DNA can replicate and can also perform transcription. Okay, and besides this DNA, okay, we also have mRNA, that is messenger RNA, tRNA, that is transfer RNA, and we also have rRNA, that is ribosomal RNA. So besides DNA, we also have RNA, that is mRNA, tRNA, and rRNA, that is ribosomal RNA. Now after this DNA, the genetic material, we have ribosomes in the matrix. Now these ribosomes are generally 70S type. You all have studied about ribosomes. They are formed of, they actually are very important organelles in the cells, and they are actually divided into two kinds. They have two types, 70S and 80S. So in the chloroplast, generally the ribosomes are 70S type. Now this is Swedberg unit. This S means this is Swedberg unit. So based on the sedimentation coefficient, they are classified into two, 70S and 80S. This S is Swedberg unit, right? So the ribosomes, the type of ribosomes present in the chloroplast is of 70S type. Next, after this ribosomes, remember these ribosomes are quite active in the chloroplast. Okay, they're quite active in the chloroplast. After these ribosomes, this matrix or stroma also has plastoglobulins. They also have plastoglobulins. These plastoglobulins are actually they contain lipids. Okay, they contain lipid pigments. They are darkly stained, but since initially what happens, they are masked by the chlorophyll. Okay, the pigment that is chlorophyll, so they do not actually appear very clearly. But after some time, when the leaves are going to get mature, and in the autumn when they are going to fall, these phytoglobulins, this lipid containing this granules, they become visible as in red color. Okay, so they are generally present in what? They are generally present in chromoplastids, means plastids which are colored, but they are also there in case of chloroplast. But in the chloroplast, their color is actually masked by the green colored pigment, that is chlorophyll, which is present in the thylakoids. But after some time, when the leaves are going to get mature and they're going to fall in the autumn, these phytoglobulins are going to become visible. They generally appear in red color. Then after this phytoglobulins, just remember that there are some very important proteins also, and the most important protein, the most important or abundant protein in the matrix is, I'm just giving you one example over here, most important or abundant protein is RUBP carboxylase. This is RUBP carboxylase. This means ribulose biphosphate carboxylase. The full form is ribulose biphosphate carboxylase. You can write it as RUBP carboxylase. Now, in the stoma, sometimes starch grains also occur. There can also be some starch grains in the stoma or the matrix in case of higher plants. Okay. So, this is what is there in the matrix or stoma. Let us recall, I told you that this matrix or stoma is actually the aqueous fluid inside this core, okay, and this is generally made up of protein colloidal complex. When I told you about the composition of matrix or stoma, I told you that proteins are in abundant composition, that is 50 to 60% approximately. So this stroma or this entire matrix is composed of this protein colloidal complex. And what else does this matrix or stroma contains? It contains granules, phytoferritin and some mineral elements. These granules are actually what? These are, you can remember this as mineral elements. Then the enzymes. Now these enzymes actually have a very important function. They help in the synthesis of photosynthetic pigments. They actually are the key enzyme. There are certain key enzymes, like I told you about rubisco. This rubisco is a key enzyme which is going to help the plants to carry out light independent reaction or the dark reaction. The enzymes also perform lipid and starch synthesis and degradation. Then we come on to the genetic material. The genetic material is in the form of DNA. And we call the chloroplast DNA as ctDNA, chloroplast DNA. It is mostly circular, but occasionally it can be linear also. There are 2 to 6 copies of this DNA, which this DNA actually makes this chloroplast as semi-autonomous. It can replicate also, it can show it is going to process further transcription also. Then there is also the presence of mRNA, tRNA, rRNA. This mRNA is messenger RNA, tRNA is transfer RNA, rRNA is ribosomal RNA. Then we have ribosomes, and we have very active ribosomes in case of chloroplast, and they are generally 70S type. As I told you, it is Swedberg unit. Then we have plastoglobulins. These are the lipid containing granules, and these actually become active when these chlorophylls are going to degenerate. Then the most important or abundant protein is the RUBP carboxylase, that is ribulose biphosphate carboxylase. Then in some higher plants, the matrix or the stroma also contains some starch grains. So this was all about matrix or the stroma. Now we'll be moving to the other one, that is the thylakoids.